just a bad worker out of apartment 5B.
You're now tuned into the Apartment 5B podcast, where we chop it up about hip-hop, R&B, sports, love, and life. Hosted by Kill. What's good?
You tune to Apartment 5B, hosted by your man, Kill. I got my squad in effect with me today. Ladies first, I got Porsche. What's good, miss?
How's it going, Kill?
Going great. It's going great. Burn, straight from Cuba. What's good, brother?
Hola, ¿cómo estás?
Nick, what's good, good brother?
Get ready to roll, man. Ready to roll.
Grab Lover, the youngest soul brother. What's good, man?
Salutations and greetings to all. What's up, y'all?
What's going on?
Got my man Ed out there on the West Coast, 115 heat, man. What's good?
Hey, man, I'm trying to keep cool, man.
I ain't no doubt. Tone from End of the Dome. What's going on, good brother?
Salute, my people. Salute.
No doubt. Y'all know me. Let's jump right into it. Today, we're talking about them sophomore albums, sophomore slumps, the cats who, you know, didn't fall for the sophomore slump. I got deep with it, so I got albums that I feel were doper than the first albums. Then I also got albums that may not have been doper, but it wasn't no sophomore slump. Then I got sophomore albums that I felt were whack, and then joints that I was just disappointed. So whatever y'all got, that's what y'all go with. We're going to start on the positive note, so sophomore albums that were positive. Vern, what you going with today?
Yeah, okay. I don't know if you could put positive in the same vein, but Life is Too Short, Todd Shaw, man, his second album. I knew about the short from Born to Mac, you know, but Life is Too Short is when I officially got on the bandwagon. You know, I like to tell that I was in high school, had this house speaker in the back of my Escort, man, so I used to knock that whole tape. So yeah, Life is Too Short.
All right, no doubt. Porsche, what you got up first?
I got Liquid Swords by the GZA, and this one, I just like this one better. I think it's better than his first album. And I didn't really know much about, he wasn't really great on that album. The production was lacking on the first one on his debut. But then this, Liquid Swords is dope because it highlighted everything he was great at with 36 Chambers. So that's the one I think is better.
All right, no doubt. For the younger viewers out there, may not know, GZA had an album when he was with Cold Chillin' called Words from the Genius. He was going by the name of the Genius. So for a lot of people may think Swords was GZA's first album, but it was actually sophomore. So just wanted to explain that to some of the folk that may not have known that. Nick, what's good with you?
I'm going to go with Alcoholics, Coast to Coast. Just a step up from the debut, 21 and Over. E-Swift was better as a producer. They had a couple of tracks from Diamond D. The chemistry between J-Ro and Tash was better. I just feel like it just kept them going in the upward trajectory in their career at that point.
Yeah, no doubt, man. Something about the licks, man. Can't sleep on J-Ro. Tash was nice. Tash was nasty, but...
Oh, yeah. J-Ro, my guy. Yeah,
so, J-Ro was my dude. Yes, nobody ever talked about J-Ro. It's just that J-Ro has some joints on it. Crab, what you got for your first joint, good brother?
Of course, I'm going to go with Family First, man, and I'm going to go with Heavy D and the Boys, Big Time.
That's
second album.
Yeah.
My bad. With that second album, man, I just saw a lot of growth. You know what I mean? Because I can remember from him being at the parties and rocking live and hearing him on tape, and then hearing him on the first album, and then hearing him on the second album. And he learned how to kind of pick tones. You know what I mean? So he knew what beat to rock, how to tone it down on the beat when he rocking us like. You ain't heard nothing yet compared to more bounce. So you know what I mean? Where the tone is higher and he's more amped, and where you ain't heard nothing yet, he's more smooth. Whereas earlier it was always up, you know what I mean? And then, but with the demo he did, this demo he did called, It's a Party, Y'all. It's a demo he did called It's a Party. He was kind of smooth on that joint, so. Yeah, but to me, I noticed the tone, him being able to distinguish tone. So that second album was it for me.
All right.
It was one of my first one.
No doubt. Ed, what you got for your first joint?
Along the lines of Porsche's pick, I got My Beat the Infamous. You know, their first album, Juvenile Hell, was very obscure. Didn't really hit, man. And I mean, you know, there's a saying, you don't get many chances. You only get one opportunity to make a first impression. But somehow they survived that, man. Came back with the Infamous. Production, man, they had that dope soundscape, man. Signature production. Worked with Q-Tip to get all of that, you know, all the extra EQing and all that stuff sounding right, you know, giving them the crisper drums and, of course, Prodigy and Havoc, you know, on the mic, you know, just subject matter and everything, just complete improvement all the ways around, man. So, classic album.
Yeah. And again, for folk, and this ain't even for the younger folk. I know folk my age, you don't even know. A lot of people think the Infamous was their first album, but they did have Juvenile Hell, We Hit It From The Back, and everything like that. The asterisk with that.
Hell.
Yeah, with Coppell.
That was my joint.
The thing about the asterisk with that album to me was that's one of the few times, and I'll give it the Outkast with AT Aliens on their second joint, where a person wasn't producing for their first album, and literally their first production was, you know, for Havoc's first production, work to be the Infamous. That's amazing. To go from not really being a producer to being able to make the Infamous. And the same thing with Outkast, from going from not making beats and then being all organized noise and then going to AT Aliens with Elevators and the stuff they were doing. Those are like those two anomalies, because you rarely find that somebody wasn't a producer on this album. And on this album, next album they're producing, five mic out. So that's just my asterisk for that. Tone, what's your next joint?
I'm gonna go with that Step Into the Arena by Gangstar. No more Mr. Nice Guy was dope, but the second album, the Beats and the Rhymes were elevated, so they were just overall better group by the time that second one came around, man. So that's the one I can go with.
Yeah, no doubt. Just to Get a Rap is actually my favorite Gangstar song, period. So
yeah, one of mine too.
Yeah, too. So I'm with you on that. The first joint I got for me, for me saying dope is doper than the first, is Illadelph Half-Life, The Roots. To me, it was doper than Do You Want More. To me, Do You Want More is too light in the ass for me. It was just, you know, too light in the ass, live instruments.
Too light in the ass for me.
But the second joint... Because that was my little beef with them. It was like, yo, no samples. Like, and I was like, I wasn't feeling that promotion. I'm sure it was the label, but that whole no samples and
a little too jazzy.
Yeah, that was a little too diggable for me. So I was like, nah, I'm good. But then Illadelph
always got those shots that diggable, man.
But yeah, Illadelph was dope. And Malik B came sharper. I thought the Bad Lieutenant, Black Thought was sharper. Everything with the beats was better. And then for it's my song, they didn't go into the Sophomore Slump, not necessarily saying it was better than, was EPMD's Unfinished Business. Of course, I like Strictly Business better, but it was no Sophomore Slump. I loved Unfinished Business, Total Chaos, so what you saying, please listen to my demo. Definitely no Sophomore Slump then. Bro, what's your next one up, good brother?
All right, so before Grap jumps in, I'm going to go ahead and throw out the main ingredient. Mecca and the Soul Brothers is definitely
Def
dope.
Def on my list. Yep.
Yeah, Mecca and the Soul Brothers is definitely dope with classy joints on there, man. But that main ingredient, bro, was just an elevation.
It's like, funny because that for me was going to be an honorable mention for the beats.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I feel like they just fit into a groove on that, man. I mean, it was a perfect marriage of everything. It's like, it's kind of like, man, I liken it to my senior year in high school. I'm on the football team. I got a job. I got a car. You can't tell me nothing. And it's like, that's how Pete and CO came on that main ingredient, bro. And that album never gets spoken of as highly as it should as it relates to all-time classic hip-hop albums.
Yeah, it had a couple of hits on it, man.
Yeah.
All right, no doubt. Porsche, what's your next joint?
Low End Theory by Tribe.
You took mine.
And the reason I have that one is because I mean, People's Instinctive was our first sort of introduction to Tribe, what they were all about, what they were coming with. But then Low End Theory was just, I don't know, they did flawless on that. I mean, Fife, we heard more Fife. He came into his own, and then production was flawless. Yep. The whole concept around the album sonically, like from the name Low End Theory, just everything about it, just completely on point. It's a perfect album. Love it. And way better than the first. So.
And they stopped dressing weird.
And they stopped dressing weird.
That's what it was for me. As soon as I saw Check the Rhyme, I seen they had on baseball hats. And I was like, all right, now I can rock with y'all. I don't know what y'all. I don't know what was in El Segundo, but now y'all can
this guy. Found a wallet and went to Modell's.
Queen.
He's like, we going to Modell's, yo.
Yo, Nick, got up next. Right, Nick, what you got up next?
Hometown, ATLians, Outkast. First album, great album. Gave respectability to MCs from Atlanta in particular, because at that point we only had Crisscross.
so, Lord, you mean free you mean,
bro?
Exactly.
He was writing for him.
He was writing the rhyme. So you know the ATLian stepped it up lyrically. Dre started dressing weird, the opposite of Tribe. but he was doing their own beats. That was just like a summer anthem, man. Great album, my favorite Outkast album.
The funny thing about mainstream. That album, when that joint dropped,
hell yeah, mainstream.
I was living in Atlanta when that joint dropped. Yeah. Like to be in Atlanta at that time, mm-hmm. nothing like it. So like, I get when some people be like, "ATLians was alright." I'm like, "Bro, you was in Atlanta."
Exactly.
Years
old. Dropped what, 96, 95?
Yeah, I think
96.
Yeah, I got married. Yep.
But that, just being an Atlanta dog, like, it was a whole nother phenomenon going on down there with that. So, definitely with that. Grant, what you got up for your next joint?
I had Low End Theory. Thanks, Porsche. I also had Step in the Arena as well. But I'm going to go with De La Soul is Dead.
Yes, that's on my list. Yep.
Mm-hmm. De La Soul is Dead, man. They just expanded more on what they did from the first album. It was a further expansion, it was a further exploration into the minds of those guys, those four guys, meaning Plug One, Plug Two, Mason and Paul. You know what I mean? And the skits were incredible. The subject matter of the songs were very unique. Very, you know, Millie pulled a pistol on Santa. You know what I mean? Afro Connections and High Five titles. Yeah. How they did the titles and what the song actually meant. You know what I mean? Like it was sick. Oodles of O's. You know what I mean? Like what it means to have to be an artist and have money and how cats treat you. And you know, the songs were like when you sit back and verbally analyzed them, they were pretty deep, but when you listen to them, they were fun to listen to. So you know, they were teaching too, so it was like a step up. So definitely De La Soul is Dead.
Yes sir.
Biddy's the lounge, ring
Roller Jam Saturday, that was
Roller Skating Jam.
You
know, remixes. Hanging out with the chicks, ring, ring, ring is them getting stressed by demo heads and, you know, clowns. I got a beat, and all that craziness. I seen it, felt it, dealt with it, so I know what it is. You know what I mean? But I'm sure not on their level. They probably are hounded constantly, you know what I mean? But, they were always giving us that information, unbeknownst to us, but it was always dope, so.
All right, no doubt. Ed, what you got up next?
Man, my next one, I got the Fugees, The Score. I liked that Nappy Heads and Nappy Heads remix from the first one. There was some other, they had some joints, man, but The Score, man, woo, you know, that just brought it all together, man. Superstars after that, man. You got Ready or Not. You got Cowboys with
Rodriguez.
Rodriguez.
On the front of them up, yeah.
Young Z and Pace One.
Family Business, Fuji La, Killing Me Softly, of course, man. Just straight up and down, man. They just came together. And it's a shame we didn't get to the third album, man.
I know.
Yeah, the crazy thing, I don't know if y'all got a chance to peep it, Prize on Drink Champs. Check that out.
I can't make it through Drink Champs, man.
I know, but
Noriega get annoying.
Make
some noise. Every 10 seconds.
If you want a good one to like get your giggle on a little bit, yo, Brand Nubian episode, man. That joint is funny.
Doc getting twisted, yo.
That's my brother, man. He gets it in, man. He is funny when he gets twisted, yo.
Yeah, but check out the Prize joint if you can. It's very dope. I skipped over it. Like, I don't want to hear what Prize got to say, but it was actually a really dope
interview. He did a pretty good Combat Jack interview, too.
Oh, Prize?
Yes, I remember that one.
I got to peep that then.
All right. Yeah, what you got, brother?
Yeah, I got By All Means Necessary. Because, you know, Criminal Minded was dope, but, you know, in retrospect, it kind of sounded like a demo. You know what I'm saying? Him and Scott was still trying to get it together, man, and put some music out, so it's raw. You know what I'm saying? It's like basement Wu-Tang RZA shit with the cow. You know what I'm saying? So, but By All Means, it was crispier. The song structure was better. You had, it was deeper in Legal Business. My Philosophy was still number one. I mean, it's just a dope project, and to me, it's still BDP's, as a group, best piece of work to me.
So
I'm gonna go with that. Yeah.
Okay. That's my favorite.
You know that said G on production too.
Right.
What is that so?
On Criminal Minded.
Okay.
Yeah. The next joint I got up, I got an asterisk by this because I think this is one of the first albums. And a lot of folk I know disagree with me on this. I got Big Daddy Kane's It's a Big Daddy Thing over Long Live the Kane. You know what I mean? I know Long Live the Kane had, you know, the classic songs on there. So a lot of people like, well, but I just enjoyed It's a Big Daddy Thing better. And to me, it's one of the first albums, well, maybe the only album that somebody left the Juice Crew and did without Marley that I felt was like still very dope. I know G-Rap had Wanted Dead or Alive, but you know, it's one of the first albums that, because usually once you left Marley, it kind of went downhill for a lot of the Juice Crew members. But for me, it was a Big Daddy Thing, Long Live the Kane, and what it that I felt was no Sophomore Slump with Jungle Brothers, Dumb by the Forces of Nature.
Yeah.
Again, I like Straight Out the Jungle better, but I was more than happy with
Dumb by the Forces of Nature. Yeah.
Very dope album.
Looking at that,
doesn't talk about a lot. Nobody really ever talks about, but it's definitely for me a 5-mic album. Vern, what you got for your third one, good brother?
My third one, I'm gonna go with It Takes a Nation of Millions. Bone vs. Show was a great introduction to Public Enemy, but It Takes a Nation of Million. Like, if they said you could put 5 rap albums in a time capsule to introduce somebody to rap, It Takes a Nation of Million is going to be one of those 5, man. You know, so enough said. I mean, if you don't know, you better find out.
Another funny thing about that, a lot of people think that's P's first album. They don't even know about Young. So, you know, that's the thing. And I'll never forget, man, I copied Yo Bum Roast the Show, hoping to hear Rebel Without a Pause. Because they had dropped that as a 12-inch that summer before It Takes a Nation came out. And I got Yo Bum Roast the Show wanting to hear that. And you could tell just how the Bomb Squad grew. Because listen to Yo Bum Roast the Show, you listen to It Takes a Nation. Yo Bum Roast the Show got some joints, but the Bomb Squad hit their peak with that.
Yes, sir.
So. Dope pick on that, Vern. I ain't even think about that. Porsche, what you got up next?
So everybody's already said all the ones I had on my list as better than their debut. But one that wasn't a disappointment, I would say Supreme Clientele by Ghost. I don't think it's better than Iron Man, but it definitely wasn't a disappointment. I think Ghost he's a monster lyrically, and I think that Supreme Clientele carried the momentum of Iron Man. So, again, dope album, very, very few skippable tracks, and production was great, everything about it was dope, so definitely not a disappointment.
All right, no doubt.
I definitely say it's better. Me personally, I think that is the Ghost album that I go back to. If someone asks me about Ghost is Killer as an MC, what's he all about, what's his sound, what's his MCing like, I'll point to that album.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, that was Dusted Ghost.
And again, at the end of the day, it is what it is. You know, some people may have it better. I got Criminal Minded better than By Any Means. It's one of them joints, again, you can't go wrong with either one. You know what I mean? Nick, what you got up next?
I'm going to go with In God We Trust, Brand Newbie. That was actually my introduction to them because I missed out on the debut album because I was like 10 when that came out. Just wasn't, you know, getting rap cassettes myself at that point. And God We Came, and God We Trust was eighth grade, so, you know, Sadat X, Lord Jamar. I think it was more militant than the first one when I went back and listened to it. The 5%, that was my introduction to that, you know, being from the South. Like, yo, what are these cats talking about? The Black Man Is God and that type of stuff. I actually prefer that to the debut, me personally. I know a lot of my older heads don't, but me personally, that's the better album, In God We Trust. Olaju Akbar, Pass the Gat, The Gods Must Be Crazy, Punks Jump Up to Get Beat Down. Just a great album.
Yeah, no doubt. Grant, what you got next, brother?
Man, y'all snatched up a lot of good stuff. I'm going to say Wu-Tang Forever. Yep. That's the second album, correct?
Yeah.
Wu-Tang Forever, that double album. That was a big album. Like how they brought it forth with that Triumph video. That was a really big video.
Yeah, really.
Just the presentation of it was really big and made you want to, you know, see what it was about. You know what I mean? So I guess the marketing of it as well was really dope. But the actual music was dope too, so.
All right.
Actually have that album somewhere right now, CD. But yeah, that's one of my Wu-Tang Forever.
Wu-Tang, and I'm actually in the minority that prefers that to 36 Chambers.
Wow.
But you gotta think about Nick, because he enlightened me to something. When he got introduced to him, you gotta think about his age. Because for me, the album that you just mentioned, I mean, for one, bro, I'm in college, I'm partying Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, so. Yeah. That encapsulates the time for me, so I get where you're coming from on that.
Right.
He was in college. I was in the fifth grade. You know
what I mean? Right. What was you gonna say, Tom?
Just real quick, you know, I did a blog about a year or two ago about Wu-Tang Forever versus 36 Chambers. Of course, Chambers has the classic Wu-Tang song, but Forever shows them as elevated MCs. They all rhyme better. The production was sharper. I mean, I know we like the grungy earlier RZA beats, just like Iron Man versus Supreme Clientele. But Forever, it's sharp. You know what I'm saying? Inspector Deck, to me, put on a lyrical exhibition on Forever. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Dose was hungry on there. I mean, everyone went crazy lyrically on Forever. The flow was tighter. To me, I always say MCs get better in time if they practice in their craft. And to me, Wu-Tang did their pinnacle on Forever. You know what I'm saying? They had all mastered their own solo albums and things of that nature, and they all brought it together perfectly on Forever. So I listen to Forever right now more than I do 36 Chambers.
Okay.
So, right. Yeah, I feel you, Graham.
All right, no doubt. Ed, what you got, a good brother?
All right, this is another one that could be a debate, whether, you know, a lot of people prefer the first album, but I say Far Side, Lab Cabin in California. Mm-hmm. And I know a lot of people prefer Bizarre Ride, but yeah, man, that album, I think it was just the sound of that album. And it was a different sound to me at the time. I mean, this was 95, so I was listening to Mobb Deep. I was listening to hard stuff. And so to have something like that came as a contrast and those Dilla beats. I mean, when I heard Drop, when I saw that video for the first time, I was so... Absolutely, man. So that's mine, and I still bump that album today. It's still one of my favorites.
All right, no doubt that Jay Dilla. Tone, what you got up next, good brother?
I got Kanye's Late Registration. You know, I like College Dropout. Does have some skippable joints on there to me personally, but the way they put Late Registration together, man, I mean, it sounded like a bigger album. Mm-hmm. It was cleaner with the production to me. I still didn't like the skits because, I mean, that's the reason why Graduation is my favorite Kanye album. I don't like skits for the most part.
Yeah, his skits were annoying.
Outside of Early Daylight, Wu-Tang, some of those skits, most skits are corny. You know what I'm saying? And Kanye has some corny skits on both his first albums, but I did feel like Late Registration was kind of a step up for us him as an MC and with the beats. So I'm gonna go with Late Registration. As far as like album, I'm not mad at. I wasn't disappointed. Mm-hmm. Follow the Leader by Eric B. and Rakim. You know, come out the Pay No Fool is tough, man. You know what I'm saying? And so it's easy to drop off. But actually, on Follow the Leader, Rakim was probably a better MC. You know what I'm saying? The song structures, the lyrics, and everything. I mean, he still had the laid back flow, but he was a little more vicious on Follow the Leader, man. So I wasn't mad at that, man. I was surprised that it was actually that good. So, I go with that one.
All right, no doubt. Next up, I got Cobb's Resurrection over Can I Borrow a Dollar? Album.
You just took it.
One of mine.
And then for a joint that I wasn't mad at, nobody likes this album. I'm one of the few people who do. I was not mad at Dos Effects' Straight Up Suicide.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I love that album.
That's coming in the next one for me.
I wasn't, but I know a lot of people be like, that one hit wonder, da da da. Yo, Straight Up Suicide, the beats weren't as dope, but lyrically, them dudes lost their fucking minds on that album, man.
Yeah, they
were
spitting.
Yeah, them dudes lost their minds on that album. To be like, yo, we gonna drop this whole style that y'all took and ran with. And we just gonna spit. Yo, give me that microphone alone is just stupid. So that's one of the joints I had that. Vern, what's your fourth joint?
All right, well, shoot, I'm gonna give two and then I'm bowing out because all the other ones have been taken. First one I'm gonna say is LL Bad. Because to be honest, I wasn't necessarily a fan of LL when it came to radio, but LL came to Atlanta with Public Enemy, DMC, I think Jazzy Jeff and Fresh Prince. It was a gang of people. And when I saw him perform at the Omni, bro, I was on LL, bro. So I'm going to say Bad. And then my last one, I'm going to just say The Foreign Exchange, Leave It All Behind. I kind of knew about him on Connected, but bro, Leave It All Behind. Put it on and just let it run to the end. I mean, that's my top 10 albums of all time. My favorite, that's on there.
Okay.
That's dope. Of course, what you got for number four?
For another album I wasn't disappointed in was Ice Cube's Death Certificate. Mm-hmm. I love America's Most Wanted. And again, same thing. I just feel like Cube was a little bit more polished. It's different than America's Most Wanted. I just think that Cube was just a little more seasoned, a little more polished, and still same sort of lyrical aggression and all that he had still carries through. So,
all right, no doubt. Nick, what you got up next?
Now, how many we doing total?
We doing
five. Okay, so I'm gonna roll with y'all took Hometown Again. I'm gonna go Still Standing, Goody Mob, Soul Food, classic. You know what I'm saying? Still Standing, not better than Soul Food.
Right.
Definitely not a disappointment. They even took a stab at producing on their own as well. Lyrically, I think they got better, especially CeeLo, and which is tough because he was the standout on the debut album. Still Standing, Goody Mob.
Yeah, that was another one of them joints I was living in Atlanta for. They don't dance no more. Black
guy. Yeah, man.
Joints.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
That's it, right? Grant, what's another one you got, good brother?
I'm pretty much done over here, but I can say one that you had said was Resurrection Common.
Mm-hmm.
That's definitely one. Like, I think what we all can agree to here is that we look for the main, one of the main things we look for in a sophomore album, and in order to kind of not call it a slump, is growth. You know what I mean? That's like the main ingredient. That's the main ingredient that makes a sophomore album dope. You know what I mean? So in mentioning all these albums that in looking at my list, that's what attracted me to writing these albums down was their growth. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So Resurrection, main ingredient, Wu-Tang Forever, Big Time, Step in the Arena, Low End Theory, De La is Dead. You know, those were the ones, but I only got two for the other side of the fence. I only got two.
Oh, don't worry, good brother. I got.
I'll be like, oh yeah.
I got you, man. Ed, you got any more positive joints?
I do, and man, I'm surprised that Nick did not mention this one. And this is an album that I've been revisiting a lot lately. Diggable Planets, Blowout Cone.
I don't bring them because I get tired of Kill dissing them all the time, so I don't bring them up on the show.
I tell you what, man. I've been revisiting that album a lot lately, man. And I mean, it sounded like it was so ahead of its time, and it aged so well, man. Yeah. And I mean, the way they're rhyming on that, man, the way they're flowing over those beats, man, because I'm thinking to myself, man, it ain't easy to flow over those beats. I mean, they're beautiful beats, man, but they're beautiful beats, man, but they did their damn thing on that album, man. Talk about regression for sure.
Yep. Pro-black as hell, too. Ask any white people why they don't like that album.
Yeah.
It Wasn't a Disappointment is Wrath of the Math, J. Rude the Damager. I feel like I got exactly what I wanted, man. Following that first album, you know? Sunrise from the East, man. It was just more of the same, man. Premier beat and him just killing it on the mic, man, lyrically. So...
All right, no doubt.
I actually got two more if we're going to, you know, transition to the disappointments.
Give me a two.
Onyx, All We Got Is Us, less gimmicky than the first album.
Yeah.
And what's the other? Where is that? Trap Music, T.I.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Boyce, you got any more positive joints?
Just There Is a Dark Side.
Okay.
By Red Man. Wasn't a disappointment at all. And Red Man, he's just a fun MC to listen to. Mm-hmm. I love him lyrically. And that one was definitely not a disappointment. And then obviously, Sean Price, Jesus Price Superstar. Mm-hmm. And I've got, Master Ace Slaughterhouse. So yeah, they're good.
Man, it took me a minute to realize Master Ace wasn't from the West Coast. With that,
for real, right?
Yeah. Rise, rise for y'all.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, what positive joints you got left?
More positive, man. Kendrick's Dookie in Mad City, mm-hmm. man. Because, you know, a lot of people sleep that Section 8 is his first album, his actual album. But it was on, it didn't get the same distribution. But Section 8, he's rapping his ass off. But Good Kid, he put it all together. It sound more like an album because Section 8 kind of sound like a mixtape to a degree, even though it's an album. But Good Kid, he elevated again as an MC. His storytelling was incredible on Good Kid, Mad City, man. So that joint, of course, one that I'm not mad at is Nas. It was written. I mean, I've been talking to people down with a blog on the website last year about, you know, Nas was a better MC on that because he wasn't just a talented young kid rhyming over Primo and Pete Rock and all those guys. It was written that the dude did I Gave You Power. He did Shootouts. You know what I'm saying? He did Taking in Blood. I mean, he did The Message. He's a better MC. People ain't trying to hit me on that. If you go back and listen to him, his rhyme structure, his storytelling, everything elevated, live nigga rap, etc., whatever. So, yeah, it was written. It was amazing, man. So, not only was it not a disappointment to me, the shit, the classic, but those are mine.
You know, and the funny thing, and I've said this a billion times, man, I really think most hip-hop heads give It Was Written so much hell just because it was, because they saw it produced by the track masters.
Well, it was the pink suit, too, though.
But
I was one of those guys.
But even before, before the pink suit, because I had a bootleg of it, and I remember listening to it in my mom's basement in Philly, trying to imagine who did what. Yo, I swore RZA did Shootouts. I was like, it was RZA. You know, Large Pro could have done Watch Them Niggas. You know? Yep. So hearing that album, I was like, yo, this shit is dope. And then when I finally saw it and I saw the track masters, I was like, I got so much more respect for them because I was like,
think about Silent Murder.
What? Yeah. Yeah.
Silent Murder on the tape. It wasn't on the CD.
Right.
I mean, this dude was amazing on It Was Written, dog.
Right.
Amazing.
I think it just all starts with that produced by the track masters. Like, seeing that, I think at that point, the track masters was like fucking AIDS or some shit. Like, no parts of that shit. You know what I mean? So, when they saw produced by the Trackmasters, they closed their ears. Trust me, that album said produced by Q-Tip. Primo did joint. Havoc did joints. If it would have said, if you took the Trackmaster name off that album and sprinkled in Pete, LES, and Large Pro, Cass would have been like 5 Mic Classic.
You're exactly right.
And so to me, that's why it gets so much help, just because it says produced by the Trackmaster.
Hey, but real quick, anybody listen, you go on Google and put in Trackmasters and look at the music they did during that time period. They got plenty of hard tracks. It wasn't just the R&B joints they were doing. You know what I'm saying? They were kind of like free Neptunes. They had hard beats.
You know, but what the problem is, back then a lot of people weren't lining to people. You know what I mean? So you would hear a Trackmaster joint, you wouldn't even know it. You know what I mean? If you saw people Trackmasters did LL's I Shot You, they gonna be like, word? Like, I ain't know. So that's what's gonna happen when you bring up those harder beats, because it's just about what you're known for. And they was just known for looping. You know what I mean?
That's true.
At the end of the day, that's the thing. So many times I get in conversation with people about Dilla, and they were like, oh, I ain't know Dilla did that. I ain't know Dilla did that. So a lot of people really don't look at them liner notes or who produced or whatever like that. But that's my two cents on it was written. The joints I got left, Hell Hath No Fury, the clip. Mm-hmm. Better than Lord Willin, M.O.P.'s Firing Squad. I know I'm a minority in this. N.W.A.'s Niggas for Life. I preferred that over Straight Outta Compton. Fonte, No News is Good News. I prefer that over Charity Starts at Home.
Yes, sir.
There's some really good. Steady B, I preferred his What's My Name album over Bring the Beat Back. Kwame, A Day in the Life. I preferred that album over The Boy Genius. And OC, Juelz, we had him on the podcast. The World, y'all.
The Word Life.
Cool. Killing me over when I say Juelz is better than Word Life. OC himself,
yep, he admitted,
on the podcast and said it ain't even close that Juelz is better than Word Life. That's what I had for that. Joints I wasn't mad at. Special Ed's Legal.
That's a tight. The album cover messed that up.
Exactly. That's what meant. You called that, Nick.
Yeah,
that
album looking like Tevin Campbell on the cover.
Goodbye.
Like, ladies.
And, jacket. I know a lot of
curly, curly Jamaican joint.
Bring that sexy man, you know. Especially.
Let me stop, yeah.
Oh, God. All right, Special Ed. I wasn't mad at Big's Life After Death. I know some people give it but Big's Life After Death to me was not a disappointment. And like, I forgot who said, I think Burns said it. Bad to me wasn't Big and Def. I was good with that after Radio. So let's go into the negative.
Oh, one more. Fat Joe, Jealous One's Envy. That's another.
Oh, that's crazy. Yeah.
Dope sophomore.
Yeah, that is true. That is true. That's true. All right, on to the wacky side of things. Whether it was whack or disappointment, however you break it down, Vern, what is one of your negative albums?
Man, okay. So to come off of a wolf in sheep's clothing, Native Tongue was just killing the game.
Heartbroken.
Bruh, that Nonfiction?
Terrible.
Moment of silence, man.
Terrible.
Moment of silence, y'all.
La da 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 da. Yeah, man, that was definitely a disappointment. I won't go as far as to say it's whack, because Dre's ain't whack. That album was definitely a disappointment for me.
Yo, I don't want to belabor this, but maybe it's another show, but maybe even, I know we kind of touched on this before, but what do you think happened with them? Like, what do you think happened for the Sophomore Slump? And maybe, you know what, we'll talk about it after we name off.
Probably Mr. Long. Wasn't he the producer? I mean, he didn't progress as a producer.
Yeah, so just open your minds and think about all these albums we name, and maybe, like, and then at the end, we kind of be like, yo, what happened? You know, because it's very hard to come off that wolf and sheep's clothing to Nonfiction, but
yeah, man.
I definitely feel you on that. Porsche, what you got?
Snoop's Dogfather.
Yeah.
Get off my head.
Dogfather killed me.
You took one of my only two.
Yeah, that's right.
Go ahead. Oh my God, let's go.
Looked like a dog.
Yeah, it was like a black cover. Had the shoes upside your head.
You know what?
The long hair.
Grab should give his opinion on this, but I tried to listen to it just a minute ago,
and I was just like,
I remember when that dropped, and that was one of the albums that I was like anticipating. I wanted to hear it because coming off of Doggy Style, I was like, no, Snoop's got to be like, if this has got to be great. It was brutal. Like it was black. Like it's brutal. I don't even think I got through. I still to this day don't think I've gone through the whole album.
I've never heard the whole album. Never. Yeah, I probably heard two or three songs.
Yeah, and it's just everything about it, from album cover to track list to lyrics to production. Everything is a miss.
I looked at it. I couldn't even listen to it. I just looked at it. Like it was one of the albums I remember. Like I was like, hold up, who had a whack ass second album? Oh, Snoop, hold up. And I typed in YouTube Snoop's second album and Dogfather came up. And I was like, that's it.
I just feel like, I know this is probably another show altogether, but Snoop's just declined since. So that slump, and 2018 he's released a gospel. Like Snoop is a mess. I don't know what happened, but I just think that slump has lasted like 15 years. So unfortunately for
that. I don't agree with that.
I like that joint he did with Count Basie recently.
Yeah.
I'm exaggerating, obviously, but Dogfather was pretty bad. That is a bad album.
I feel what you're saying. Let's not act like we sitting around waiting for a new Snoop album.
Thank you, Kittle.
He sounds like he mailing them rhymes on all them guest verses, like, do it. Come on, Snoop, bro. Come on, bro.
Then, like, DOC was why he was sharp on Doggy Style.
Yeah.
Oh. And to me, I never even heard the Dogfather. As soon as I heard you ain't messing with Dre, I'm good. Like, I'm like,
I gave him the benefit of the doubt coming off of Doggy Style, but that, it was bad. Like, it was real. I was like, really? Really? Like, yeah, I know.
Yeah, I feel you. Nick, what you got for one?
Wu-Tang Brother, Raekwon and Moba Larry.
Oh, I have that one too.
Talk about disappointment.
Yes.
Only built for Cuban links.
Yeah.
Bruh, come on.
Yeah.
That shit was, outside of sneakers, and I'm not saying that just because Graf is on here.
Nah.
That's the only joint.
Yes. They almost messed that joint up.
I think, was fire.
What it went down with that, I think they tried to mix that record themselves and almost messed that record up.
Thank God they didn't.
If you ever get Pete on here, ask him about it. He can kind of probably tell you. He may not want to talk about it, I don't know, but he can kind of tell you what it was. I think it was that they tried to mix it themselves and then kind of got jacked, and then he was a little vexed about it. But then I think he went in and fixed it or something, but it was crazy. But yeah,
that's the only joint.
Yeah,
that was a big drop off from the classic, the Purple Tape. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
No doubt. Grab, I know you only got two, so what's your second joint?
My second joint, believe it or not, is the I&I album that never happened. So that's the disappointment. It's the fact that it never happened. So yeah.
So y'all worked on another one after?
No, we were still like we recorded a remix of Center of Attention. We actually recorded over that beat that on the I&I Lost Tapes beat, the Rest in Peace Fife beat.
Yeah.
We actually recorded over that beat too as well. So it was like that was after all the initial album songs were done. You know what I mean? So we were still recording, but then Rob O did Wonderlust, which was basically like his peace out letter to I&I. So once he did that, and then he went solo, and then that was that, really. You know what I mean? So I kind of went back to the lab, started making beats. I made Half Man, Half Amazing, the J Live stuff, and then I started, doing solo works and things like that. So yeah.
Oh, so okay. Never really. I didn't know that.
Yeah. So it never really materialized like it should have. But I always wondered what it would have sounded like, second album.
So like Center of Attention, was that supposed to drop 95 or 96?
The Life I Live, it was supposed to drop in 90, When did Fake and Jax drop? Because it's supposed to drop shortly after that. April of 96?
No, I think April of 95, I think.
95? Well, whenever it was supposed to drop shortly after that. Because it was done. You know what I mean? The album was pretty much done. And, it was supposed to drop shortly after that.
Man. Right. No doubt. Ed, what's one of your negative joints, good brother?
Man. Big disappointment. Big pun. Yeah, baby.
Oh, boy. Yes,
I don't know what they were thinking on that album, man. I mean, yeah, rest in peace to Pun. Supreme
the
Lyricist.
Logo alone.
Yeah.
That logo was much. That logo was a little reek, man. That was a little reek. Maybe him holding a mic. Maybe him holding a mic, but him as a joint.
Yeah.
Yes, bro.
Yeah, man. I was
That's
just
when that logo started, right?
Yeah.
That logo started on that album,
on
right?
Second album. Yep.
Yeah.
And I try to revisit that album so many times. I can't do it, man. I think they were just chasing the hits, man. They got one with Still Not a Player on the first, and they just trying to chase them hit. Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Exploitation, man. Come on. Come on, man. Y'all know that man can jump that
second. Yeah, but he didn't sound like the other thing, man. He didn't sound like he was flowing the same on that album.
And that weight gain, man, he was huge.
Yeah.
Huge. They said he had like sit like, on the couch.
They're supposed to get him on. You know, he could have still been Big Pun, but Big Pun with muscles, man. Like,
yeah, man.
That was crazy.
You know,
man.
He tried, man. They brought him down here to Duke here in North Carolina a few times, man. He was in this program, man. But, you know, obviously it was just, at that point, I think it was too late with his health. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Man.
Yeah. Man. Unfortunate.
Health is wealth, man.
Yes, sir.
Yes, it is.
All right, Tom, what you got for one of your negative joints?
Man, I hate to say this. I'm a big fan of Slick Rick, man, but that Ruler's Back, man, hurt my heart. Because, you followed up Great Adventures, which is obviously one of the best hip-hop albums of all time, legendary, et cetera. Now, obviously, Slick got into that trouble, so they was kind of rushing that album, you know what I'm saying, because he had just got sentenced and whatnot. So they threw the rest of the shit together, and it kind of sounded like he was throwing it up. You know what I'm saying? I like that Mistakes of a Woman in Love with Other Men, join or something like that.
It's a boy,
Yeah, but I shouldn't have done it, I believe, but I was on there also. But yeah, man, it just didn't sound, it wasn't a great album, man. It was a big disappointment for me, you know what I'm saying? So I think it came back a little bit better with Behind Bars, but it still was kind of, he had pretty much lost his steam at that point, man. So that was the beginning of the end for him.
All right, no doubt.
Behind Bars was the third
yeah,
one, right?
Yeah, he did come back with All the Storytelling in like 98. That was a good album.
Right, and that's the one Pete worked on, the Behind Bars.
That was, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Get a Job, Captive.
Yeah.
Y'all ever heard Gambling?
Nah. Don't tell me it's an unreleased Pete and Slick Rick joint out there.
Yeah, y'all got to go on YouTube and check that joint. That's pretty crazy. Gambling was dope. I remember
that.
Those tapes, man. Oh, those tapes were awesome. Used to have the Chub Rock Big Man remix and then Gambling right after that. And, like it was the Green Street cassette, like, and he would, you know, have a build, you know, he would build it as he did the remixes, he would throw them on the tape, you know what I mean? And there was one tape with like four or five of them ill ass joints on there, like Gambling, Get a Job, and then before that, it was the Big Man remix, the Chub Rock. I'm still wishing I could hear that remix. Yeah. Pete got me joints, man. Heavy D Every Day, man, listen.
Yo, hear the wild thing about Grap. Grap got so much stuff in his phone that's stupid, man.
And that's the, I don't have nothing, yo. Like, oh, I wish I had what, I wish I had some of the other stuff that we did and some of the stuff from Green Street, man, and some of the stuff, just that I had access to, man. Ooh.
Yo, when we did the live show in D.C., Grap, we stayed for probably about an hour and a half after the show ended, just listening to Grap's phone.
I had a few SP joints in there from Pete, and then I had some other stuff. But yeah. It's the tip of the iceberg, I'm telling y'all. That man got music, man. That man got music.
Here's the wild part with me, man. This joint right here is one of my favorite albums of all time, man.
Wow.
Molly Mall in Control, man. I remember as a kid seeing this, seeing them out on the airplane like that, seeing the Juice Crew.
Yeah.
Oh, they got money.
Y'all could only understand how hype I was for
Volume 2
for your Staring Pleasure. Like, I'm like, all right, you know what I mean? Like, I'm ready. I'm driving now for your Staring Pleasure. All we gonna give me. Yo, that shit was so whack, man.
Soundtrack to my driving life. Not for you.
Whack, that was, I don't know. And I know, like, production styles were changing because it was become a little more R&B-ish. And you know what I mean? Kind of like, even if you listen to Craig G's second album, God, I forgot the name of it. Do I have it up here? But it was more R&B. He had a little singing group he was rocking with. So, that was like one of my biggest letdowns was Molly Mall in Control 2 for your Staring Pleasure. I don't know too many people. I think he tried to do a symphony part 2. It was bad all the way around.
Yeah, it was not good.
Yeah, it was not good.
That's not, We Write the Songs is not on that album, is it?
No. We Write the Songs is on this with Heavy D and this. That's on. That was crazy when they used We Write the Song.
Stupid. Yeah, that beat is stupid.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Vern, what you got up next?
All right, here's a challenge. Gun to your head. You ain't gonna ever see your family again unless you can name 3 or 4 songs off of No Man's Land.
Oh, you talking
Souls
Initiative?
Yeah.
Oh, why are you doing that, man? Yeah. I like them dudes, man.
I like them too. But bro, to go from 93 till infinity to No Man's Land. Yeah. Ah, it's gonna be a no for me, dog, like Randy Jackson. Okay, rebut me. Dispute it.
Yeah, anybody can say they family right now?
No, I can say it's disappointing. No, I'm in a minority that actually like that album. It just ain't 93 till infinity. I feel them on that. Yeah. Not even close.
Mind you, anything on my list, I ain't saying it's whack. But
no, that's it.
It's a steep fall off
from 93 till infinity. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Mm. For sure.
I'm hugging my wife and kids. I don't know them songs, man.
Exactly.
That's when you lost. That's not on there, right?
Nah.
See?
I mean, I had to do research to even tell you why I didn't like it, because I ain't heard.
I'm like, that's when you lost? Boom! Yeah. Dude, that's when you lost. Wow! Oh,
damn. Yeah. All right. So the mischief, not No Man's Land.
No Man's Land. All right, what you got, Porsche?
That I was disappointed in was Lil Kim's Notorious K.I.M. Mm. I liked hardcore. I thought it was a dope album. I think she really had like a lane. Then I don't know what happened in Notorious K.I.M. It just veered off that lane, whatever it was, and I was just wildly disappointed. Lil Kim's one of my favorite female MCs, and that one was just not all there.
Well, here's the easy thing with that, Big Dot.
Yeah, exactly. And I didn't want to say it, but it's true. It is. And obviously, like, she had a couple other ones come out after, and again, same thing. That slump just kind of lasted a while. So
yeah,
it stopped.
Birds are reforming. Nick, what you got, dude, brother?
I don't even know the name of the album, but it's Lords of the Underground second album. Whatever that one's called. You know, like the first one had hits.
Yeah, Here Comes the Child.
Lord Jackson. It had hits on that one. But that second album, it's just like. Name a song off of that one.
I can't. No, I'm still stuck on trying to name the album. We can name the album. So
whatever the second one is called, Lords of the Underground, it was a letdown from the first album.
All right, no doubt. Grant, I know you don't have nothing left, so if you ever want to chime in, just chime in. Eddie, what's another one of yours, man?
Hey, man, I got Noriega, Melvin Flint, The Hustler.
Yeah, we were just joking about that in the timeline.
We were just talking about that, yeah, man. And you know what? I was a fan. I was a fan of CNN, Capone and Noriega, you know, underground classic album. So, you know, the first N.O.R.E. album, you know, sound nothing like that, man, but it was still dope. You know, Noriega, he found his lane separate from Capone. And so that Melvin Flint, huge disappointment. I mean, I don't know, man. He's not the best MC, don't get me wrong, but what he did well. And that just didn't do anything for me, that second album.
That second one is actually funny. Like, if you want to laugh, like, the rapping is so bad on it, you will laugh.
So in his defense, right? he did the song. You know the song he did with Capone, The Reunion. He admitted to that album being whack.
Oh, yeah.
You know
what I mean?
He said he lost his dad and he made a half-ass album. I can respect that he admitted to that joint being hot.
Yeah, exactly. You know
I mean? It's got Animal Thug interlude on it. I can't diss it.
No, Animal Thug is on the debut.
Animal Thug. Isn't there an Animal Thug 2 on that one?
There is. I got the track list. It's Animal Thug. It's called Animal Thug Goes to Hollywood.
Yeah, and I can't diss anything that's got Animal Thug's my favorite thing. It's like comedy, pure comedy in hip hop, and I love it. So
was it like if the skit is the most memorable thing on your album, you know it's bad.
That's when you lost. That's when you lost.
You are absolutely right about that, Nick. I cannot argue that.
No, I'm still stuck. We gonna see which one's the worst. I think Lords of the Underground is worse. We can't even name the title of the album.
I don't know what it was called.
We don't even know what it's called. So Tone, what's one for you, good brother?
I'm gonna go with Mos Def, The New Danger, man. Now, look, don't get me wrong. There's some tracks on there. Of course, most of the amazing MC. So, yeah, he got some joints on there that's fire. But coming out for Black on Both Sides, Black on Both Sides to me is like perfection in hip-hop.
Mm-hmm.
Beats, the rhymes, you know what I'm saying? The vision of the album, how creative it is and things of that nature, man. It's one of the best albums I've ever heard in the genre to me personally. So following that, expectations are very high. But New Danger to me just kind of thrown together. It felt like it's like, okay, I need to get some music. I got some music stashed away. Let me kind of put it together. It didn't flow. It was kind of all over the place a little bit, man. I was hoping a whole lot more for Mos. He did come back on the Ecstatic and kind of put it back together again, but that new danger was not good. Real quick, I do have one that might be worse than that Lords of the Underground joint, and it's Danny Dane's second album, Danny Dane Forever. That shit is terrible.
I didn't even know he had a second.
Yeah, he is. So obviously Danny Dane with Fame is a dope album. You know, I still call him the fake Slick Rick. You know what I'm saying? But the Danny Dane Forever sophomore joint is just, it was all Herbie Love Bug again, and it just didn't work.
Here's the thing. I'm still, my vote is still with Lords of the Underground because at least we know the name of that album. We still.
We look that up real quick.
I don't even want to look it up. I want somebody to rack their brain. Because what's up?
Now, the thing about the New Danger, that's when all the rappers wanted to experiment.
Yeah.
So, like, Andre did the Love Below Q-tip in that time.
Q-tip. Yeah, I ain't like that either. But anyway.
Kamal, the Abstract. And who was the other one? Comment with Electric Circus.
Yeah, I ain't like that either. All them experiments suck to me, but that's just me.
No, that ain't just you. You ain't the long range.
Yeah,
man. All right, the next joint I got up, Out of Queens, Flushing, Mike Geronimo, Vendetta.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Coming on.
The puffy touch.
Yeah, coming on. But I call, you know, The Natural joint is one of my most slept on 90s R&B bangers.
Oh, that's when he went for the suits and all of that?
Yeah. That's when he had the first single was Making Moves with Puff.
With Puff Daddy.
And again, we got to give it up to Soul Brother Number Rock, just like on Immobility.
Saving Grace.
And the only joint on there, Unstoppable.
Yes, that's with the Marvin Gaye joint.
Marvin sample. Yeah, he killed it. So that's between Immobility.
Hold on. Look, making moves with Puff. Making moves with Puff. That had that Is It Magic sample in there.
I don't grab, to be honest with you. I don't know. I like
blue.
I saw it.
Is that that
right? I think that was a Craig Mack song.
All right, I'm sorry, y'all.
The Craig Mack.
I'm trying to make it as good as the G-Dep record. I'm gonna go listen to it again. My bad, yo.
Don't go listen to it. Save your
time. Time is too precious.
Be married with kids. That's time to be talking to your daughter. Time spending with wifey. It's too many things to be doing.
Besides listening to that song.
Again, I pronounce it Immobilarity. He saved that with Sneakers. He saved with Unstoppable. Because that Mike Geronimo joint was horrible. And then the cover was whack too, with just his foot up in the camera with the Vendetta on the Timberland boot.
Hey,
that
song Usual Suspects, man, with DMX, Ja Rule, the Lox, and Tragic Gaddafi, that joint went hard though, the last track on that.
That was on there? See, I probably didn't get there. After a while, man, that was just Oh, that's Keepers of the Funk.
Yeah, there we go. That's the name of the Lords of the Underground joint.
Lords of the Underground, Keepers of the Funk.
Keepers of the Funk.
Don't listen to that one.
Okay. All right, Vern, what you got up next, man?
All right. T-I-M-E.
Leaders of the New School.
What's the name? Save Them with a remix, Large what's Professor.
Oh, he did that What's Next remix?
That was enough. I didn't. What's next?
that's the only song I can play.
It was like, what's next?
Milo, man, I know you're somebody's cousin, but dude, put the mic down. You know, it was discombobulated. They was arguing and fighting on MTV. It was,
I just had something kind of pass it to me.
Yeah, so
Milo in the dance.
Yeah,
yo,
man.
Milo in the dance, son.
So, you know, a future without a past, you know, sprung in, leaders of the new school. It's this whole new crew. And even then, you know, I had some questionable people, you know, that's somebody's cousin. Or, you know, mama said he couldn't go to the party unless he brought somebody with him. But definitely, man, when they went to that second album, it was over. So, yeah, that's my vote.
So, somebody posted a Charlie Brown and Dinko D cut. I didn't even respond, just out of respect. But it's just a done deal. Busta Rhymes was the Lone Star. That was a wrap.
I got a story that I tell offline when we get finished with the show.
I know what's the name was writing rhymes for BBD too, Charlie Brown.
I heard that.
I think the way that happened, I could be wrong. I'm theorizing the way that, because he seemed like he did it with us. He kind of floated into a session and kind of was trying to not impose himself, but just like, yo, I could, you know, do this. I could do that. So he probably floated up in their session like, oh, let me write that rhyme. And boom, you know, I don't know if he ever got paid or proper credit, but yeah, he wrote some rhymes backstage.
Bro, listen to the lyrics on that. Listen to the words of that. That's so problematic. Backstage, underage, adolescent.
How you doing? Fine. She replied. High sign.
Backstage, underage, adolescent. And
little kid wave.
Man, that's probably
little high school's wave, yo.
Keep on the high sign.
Yeah, that was a problem. My fault, y'all, but we sliding off. Y'all gotta catch me now.
Forrest, what you got?
Actually, everyone named the ones I had. So Immobilarity, Mos Def. Yeah,
I think we're waiting for your list. You had like the full.
I got a couple more.
Oh, I have another one.
All right, Tom, what you got?
I got the Ja Rule Rule 336. Wow. No, so
I don't think we like the first one.
Exactly.
No, I'm gonna tell you, me personally,
I never heard a Ja Rule album.
No, there's some fire on that first one, dog.
Is that a problem?
Yeah, no, I ain't. Hey, for me personally, yo, that Vinny Vanni Vici, whatever, I don't even know how to pronounce the shit. But anyway, Story to Tell, the joints with like Murdergram or whatever. I mean, he had a lot of dope songs.
It was a more street album.
It was almost all street, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. With Eric Sermon. Yeah, man, he had some fire on that. But, you know, his big album was that sophomore album. But I don't really care for the little club bangers that he had on there. Mm-hmm. It was kind of pop to me, but I get it. He became a big star. He became a big star with that second album, man, but I didn't like it. But I really liked that first album.
Yeah, he found that formula on the second.
Shit, go back and listen to that first album. Them beats bang on there, dog.
You got any other joints?
Oh, I got one.
For the whack joints, you guys named all the ones I had too.
I got a couple more.
What you gonna say, Nick?
The Razzcast, the Resassination.
Yeah.
I mean, his first one wasn't that great either, but the second one, you know, he tried to do the mainstream reach, working with Dre and it, just changing his whole style to get the commercial acceptance, and it ain't work out for him.
Burn, you got some more?
Yeah, I got a couple more. So, this album was not whack, but it was a vast departure from their first album. Beastie Boys, from License to Ill to Paul's Boutique.
Paul's Boutique. Mm-hmm.
Was totally different sonically, lyrically. I like some joints on there, but I mean, you set for frat boy, you know, hijinks, and you put on Paul's Boutique. It's like, man, what is this? What are they doing?
Yeah, so
that's one. Boogie Monsters. That God sound.
Yeah.
So, yeah,
yeah, it was very much of a letdown.
Yeah, Riders of the Storm. That first album was. Ooh, yes, sir. That first one.
Riders of the Storm.
Had joints. God Sound.
Who was that?
Boogie Monsters.
Boogie Monsters.
Oh. You know, Recognize Threshold, Negative Stress, Boogie. You remember them joints.
Honey Dips and
Yeah. Vex is out here in Baltimore, I believe. I think he lives in Baltimore.
Okay.
Yeah.
Another one is, for me, Lupe from Food and Liquor to the Cool, he lost me.
Didn't somebody on here kill? Didn't you call that a classic? The Cool?
No.
Somebody called that a classic for me. I must have been watching something else.
I got another one too. Helter Skelter, Magnum Force. Actually, Boot Camp Kid, the whole second wave was a disappointment. From the first set of albums they dropped.
Ask about Black Moon's second album. What was that second album?
Warzone.
I actually like Black Moon's second album.
Come on, Kill. 6 years.
I don't remember it being whack or nothing. But
yeah, I can definitely understand it.
It's not whack, but you wait 6 years for that?
I mean,
6 years, bro.
I feel you. But I'm one of those people who didn't dislike it. Like, Two Turntables and a Mic was the R&B single, but they got the Onslaught on it with Busta, the Beat Miners. I mean,
it's not whack. I'm just saying disappointment.
Saying it didn't have any oomph towards it. It didn't have no "I Got You Open" or "Who Got the Props."
Yeah. How many MCs? None of that on
there. It spoke to you. I definitely got it.
But the Magnum Force, I didn't like that. God Bless the Dead, because Sean Price, my nigga, but the Magnum Force album was weak.
Yeah. And since we on the Boot Camp, one of mine was Smith & Wesson, Rude Awakening. I mean,
yeah, Coco Brothers.
I love The Shining. I mean, I catch up. Yeah. I love The Shining. That's one of the top 10 albums. I mean, I know I'm in the minority, but
I love it. I love that album too.
This is where I lose people. Like, you're with me now, but the things I'm about to say.
I know. I saw it. I'll
take it better than Purple Tape. I'll take it better than The Infamous. I'll take The Shining with me almost over damn near anything. Like, I love.
I'll take it over The Infamous, not The Purple Tape.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, I love The Shining. Like, that just spoke to that whole. That was me at that time. Tim's camo, all that. Again, not saying any of the things I'm taking it over is whack, but if you put The Shining is damn near coming with me. You put out anything to me in the 90s, not damn near The Shining is coming with me over damn near anything. You know what I mean? I'm just talking about on a road trip. I'm always looking at things. If I got to drive from
right out to it,
with one CD, you know, what am I taking? The Shining is going to trump a lot of things. So when I heard The Rude Awakening, I was just like, yo, what the fuck? You know what I mean? But a lot of that goes back to they stopped rocking with the Beat Miners. So a lot of those, whoever was handling the production, I don't know. I think Buckshot was doing some, and then they was trying not to pay for samples. So
yeah, doing like live instruments.
And they was like trying to do live instruments, and even the Boot Camp when they finally had their compilation out for the people, that was
yeah,
because the people, the only saving grace on The Rude Awakening with Spanish Harlem that the Beat Miners did with Tony Touch,
yeah.
Hurricane G. You know what I mean? So that was one of mine. Another one, not it was whack, but a letdown, Reflection Eternals, RPM album. You know what I mean? Because I love Reflection Eternals' first album.
Yeah.
It was like, boom, finally High Tech and to live back together again.
Yeah, I think they waited too long. That was like 10 years in between
albums. Yeah, it was 10 years. Yeah.
And then just nothing hit me on that. Another letdown. There was a lot of letdowns in 98 because I want to say the music was changing. Because at the time I was living in Atlanta and the Rude Awakening came out that year. Jay-Z was in my lifetime. Mm-hmm. Bob 1 came out that year that I was in. We all know that album was like half whack, half dope. Like him trying to
Lifetime Volume 1.
Yeah, that's the joint with Black Street, The City Is Mine, the joint he had with Foxy Brown.
When he split down the middle.
Right. Down the middle. It's like, let me try this big formula. None of that shit worked, but then you got Streets Is Watching, Where I'm From, you know, the 498. But just disappointed in that. So it's crazy because that Mike Geronimo, Smith & Wesson, and Jay-Z all dropped in 98. So you could definitely see that something was changing in the music during that time. Y'all took my L.O.N.S. time. And that's it.
Oh, another disappointment. Rakim's second solo. What was that? Because he had the 18th letter. No,
the master.
Yeah, that was not whack. Just a drop off from the previous album. Kind of a disappointment.
It was some of the beats, man. The lyric, man. Rakim was sharp, man.
Yeah, Primo, no doubt.
Primo did a track on that Wait for the World, man.
Hell
incredible,
yeah.
Man. Lyricism, but I think of some of the beats is kind of boring. I think Art Kid did some beat. It's just the production wasn't great. It's kind of dated.
Now, y'all know me. I listen a little bit of everything, so I got some R&B stuff in here. Burn, I know, Nick, I know you don't rock with R&B. Some of the R&B joints I had that was doper than the first, and I know I'm still the only person who still likes this white man. Justin, Sex, Love Sounds.
Justin Trump, what you say? Justin Trump? Justin Timber Trump?
Yeah.
Wait a second. Justin
Rock. He even putting on like the Outback. In the woods, uniform and
everything.
Like, he's
Trump
all the way now.
I ain't know, man. I thought he was just back to his white boy shit.
Nah, that's exactly what he's back to.
Yeah, great again.
Back to his real white boy shit.
Something people don't agree with me on. I like Jodeci's Diary of a Mad Band better than Forever My Lady.
Who don't agree with you?
And a lot of people, man.
That's when they just grew and got crazier, yo.
A lot of people.
Listen to the like, title, man.
Hey, Forever My Lady. Those are classic joints, but I just.
Yeah, they were fiending.
Yeah, I mean. Yeah,
God, it was killing it, yo.
Yeah, they killed that second album.
The second album was,
killing it.
Was crazy. And Mary's My Life over 411.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. It was better.
More pain.
Yeah, much more pain. Joints that I felt were R&B wasn't a sophomore slump, but not better than the original, D'Angelo's Voodoo.
Mm-hmm.
When it dropped, I thought it was better, but just throughout time, I always grab Brown Sugar more.
Exactly.
You know, that's that. Bilal, I know a lot of people never heard Love for Sale. It was unreleased.
That shit is good. That shit is good.
He's
not better than Firstborn Second, but very dope album, Badu, Mama's Gun.
Is it available? Can you get it?
Nah.
I'll send it to you. I got it. I'll send it to you after this.
But Maxwell's sophomore album was incredible, too.
Who's that?
Maxwell's sophomore album was incredible, man. Embryo.
Embryo.
I don't think it's better than the first. But I do like it. I do like it. A lot of people called it trash. But I do like that.
Yeah, I don't know how to call that trash, man. The music on that Sweetback is the production team for Sade. They actually did.
That's her rhythm section.
Exactly right. Them dudes incredible, man.
So, yeah, their album was dope too. That's so their album.
Yeah, it's very dope.
Yeah. I think what it was, a lot of people, it's like I always gave this analogy. If you go out to dinner and you ask for a Sprite and the way to bring you the water, when you taste it, it's not wrong with the water. You just had your mouth ready for that Sprite. You know what I mean? So I think that's how it was with a lot of stuff. Like, Embryo is dope. I just think people coming off of the first Maxwell album didn't get what they expected.
Going to hear Till the Tops Come Knocking Part 2. It's like Nas, you want to hear The world is yours. You know what I'm saying? No, it's time for taking them blood. You know what I'm saying? So I get what you're saying. It's like, you know, you get stuck in a certain sound and you don't want the artist to kind of expand themselves a little bit, but yeah, they did.
Yeah, it was dope, though, when I think about it.
Another joint I had was John Legend's second album, Once Again. Again, not doper than Get Lifted. I know a lot of people didn't like it. I put it on. He was like, yo, is this nigga playing in Vegas or something? Like,
Lounge singer.
You know, it definitely wasn't the sound to Get Lifted because Jay didn't do the whole album, keeping in mind Jay produced that joint. Yeah. The first joint. And then the last one I got, and the asterisk I put on this is, I always tell people, very seldomly does an artist leave a producer that they have a great chemistry with and go on to make doper music. I don't know too many people who did it other than her, but Aaliyah is one in a million. Again, I loved AJ Nothing But a Number. I know a lot of folk out there don't rock with R&B, but AJ Nothing But a Number.
Timbaland and Missy.
Yeah, that was her first thing.
R. Kelly was one of the biggest producers walking the earth. Mm-hmm. You know, Steve R. Kelly was like unheard of. You know what I mean? But then they were able to scoop up a young Missy and Tim, you know what I mean? Basically run with them. Like, that's unheard of. Like, most people, when they leave, like, Genuine, when he was like, I'm not messing with Timbaland, I stop messing with you.
He fell off.
Gasoline to drizzle over to some matches, yo. Missy and Timbaland, yo. Woof.
You know, most times when people leave their main producer, you know, they don't really achieve anything. Like, if CL is like, yo, I'm leaving Pete, niggas are like, well, we kind of done with CL, you know, like,
that's what happened.
Google Lee Primo, it's like, well, this is what happens, you know. So Aaliyah was one of the few times that I could be like, she left, you know,
got better, and basically
was the first person to come into that whole Timbaland Missy camp and everything like that. You know, I mean, and usually you could tell, like, when I saw Janet messing with Jermaine Dupri, I was like, Jermaine trying to get Sam out of there, you know, and then, yeah, you know, or, you know, Alicia Keys, I seen her messing with Swiss. I'm like, oh, man, it ain't gonna be.
Never
lead their main person. They never really achieved that same success. So that Aaliyah joint, the only really whack R&B sophomore albums I had, I'll Be Sure's Private Time and the Whole Nine. Coming off of that first.
In effect mode, man.
I can't tell y'all how hype I was for this album, and it was nothing. Another joint, Jill Scott's second album. Not saying it was whack, but it just to me wasn't as dope as the first one. One of the main reasons, in my opinion, that Touch of Jazz crew. Mm-hmm. You talk about eight different producers, so even though they're a crew, you still getting eight different. Mm-hmm. Went out to L.A., started acting, started doing her thing like that. So. That's that. Anybody got anything?
I got two more. One plus one minus. Man, don't sleep on that guy, the Future album. Teddy Riley was in his bag, bro.
Oh, yeah. That's a dope album. That's a dope album.
Yes, sir.
Let's Chill remix version with the video. Yeah.
Tease Me Tonight. Her, all them joints. And then a letdown. Dang, I just lost my train of thought. Shucks. Come back to me. Let's see, this guy. I lost my train of thought.
Kill, did you say that Mama's Gun by Erykah Badu?
Yeah, I said Mama's Gun.
Okay, I didn't hear you. I'm sorry. Yeah, that's a dope follow-up to me.
Mm-hmm.
Very dope. Very dope. All right, Tone, give them all the information, man. Let them know where they can get at you, man.
Yeah, check out the B-Roll Network on YouTube, EntoTheDome.com. Also, the B-Roll Network, check out That Time in Hip Hop, the podcast with me and my man, Babe. EntoTheDome.com, EntoTheDome. Insta Dome, Twitter, check me out.
All right, no doubt. Ed, give him everything, good brother.
EddieD80 at Twitter, and I got some information there.
All right, Grap Lover, where can they get the younger soul brother?
What's good, y'all? Have named me Grap. HEVNAMEDMEGRAP on Twitter. That's me. All right, got some new things bubbling, some new things coming. Don't want to really put the mentions on them yet. You know what I mean? Let the magic keep working, and then boom, y'all will get some good stuff coming. But a couple people that I'm going to be having some things with soon, so be on the lookout.
That's what it is. Nick, what's good with you, good brother?
Kill or have it linked up on Twitter and IG.
All right.
On the post.
No doubt. Give all your stuff, Liz.
Sorry? Oh, me?
No, give them all your stuff.
Cherche La Porsche on Twitter and IG.
All right. Vern, give them everything, good brother.
VE Channel 10 on Instagram and V Channel 10 on Twitter.
All right. You already know this with me, Kill889, Twitter, IG. Got a project out right now with my man Manhattan Mayor called Killing Myself. That out. Got some dope beats, dope rhymes. So yeah, I get all with all y'all next week, man. Good luck.
Deserve.
Oh, it's a pleasure to meet you.
Yeah, you too.